إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله قال الله تعالى في القرآن المجيد بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم شهر رمضان الذي أنزل فيه القرآن هدى للناس وبينات من الهدى والفرقان فمن شهد منكم الشهر فليصم ومن كان مريضا أو على سفر فعدة من أيام أخر يريد الله بكم اليسر ولا يريد بكم العسر لتكملوا العدة ولتكبروا الله على ما هداكم ولعلكم تشكرون أما بعد. Dear brothers and sisters, we begin by praising Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We send peace and blessings upon Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, upon his companions, and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us from those who follow in their footsteps. Ameen. Alhamdulillah, Ramadan is just a few days away. And once Ramadan starts, there's a few things that we need to keep in mind in order to really optimize our time during the month of Ramadan. The first thing that I'd like to mention is that Ramadan has been mentioned only once in the Quran. Throughout the entire Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions Salah numerous times. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about fasting a couple of times. But the month of Ramadan itself has been mentioned only once. And when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned the month of Ramadan, He mentioned something very specific. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Baqarah, He says, شَهْرُ رَمَضَانَ الَّذِي أُنزِلَ فِيهِ الْقُرْآنِ هُدًى لِلنَّاسِ وَبَيِّنَاتٍ مِّنَ الْهُدَى وَالْفُرْقَانِ. That the month of Ramadan is the month wherein the Qur'an was revealed. So even before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decided to speak about what we usually know about the month of Ramadan, whenever you ask a Muslim about the month of Ramadan, in fact, even when you ask a non-Muslim, you know, what happens during the month of Ramadan? What do Muslims do during the month of Ramadan? Immediately Muslims, non-Muslims will reply by saying that, you know, Ramadan is the month of fasting. We fast during the month of Ramadan. And that's where our mind usually gets into immediately, that the month of Ramadan equals fasting. And that is true, that during the month of Ramadan, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made fasting mandatory upon every single one of us, with conditions, that is. But in this ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala introduced Ramadan in a very different manner. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions that the month of Ramadan is the month when the Quran was revealed. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not say otherwise. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not mention that the month of Ramadan is the month wherein you will fast from dawn to dusk. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not mention that this is the month wherein you will be fasting for the entire month and all the requirements. Rather, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala introduced the month of Ramadan by saying this is the month wherein the Quran was revealed. Right from there on, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is establishing something very important for all of us. And that is, the month of Ramadan should be understood as the month of the Quran. The month of Quran, that's what it should be understood as. What's very interesting is that along with Ramadan being the month of the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has also prescribed a certain act of worship, which is fasting. So the month of Ramadan is the month of the Quran along with the month of fasting. Now, what's the correlation between fasting and the Quran? Why did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not just simply mention that this is the month of Quran and, you know, in this month you'll have to read double or triple the amount of Quran that you usually read, or this is the month of the Quran and you'll have to memorize this many parts, or whatever it may be. Rather, there's, along with the Ramadan being the month of the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says during this month you'll also have to fast. Now, one thing about fasting is that, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in the Quran, in fact, just two ayahs before this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that fasting kutiba alaykum siyam kama kutiba ala alladhina min qablikum la'allakum tattaqun, that fasting had been made mandatory upon you as it was made mandatory upon the nations prior to you. In other words, the month of Ramadan necessarily wasn't the month when all the other previous nations fasted. The previous nations, the previous Muslims, the previous believers, they all had this concept of fasting. In fact, their fasting was a little different from ours. Their fasting, along with abstaining from food, drink, and intimacy, they had one extra condition of fasting. The people before, their extra condition was that they would not speak. In Surah Maryam, Zakariya alayhi salam says that I took an oath to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that I will not speak. In other words, that was the type of fasting that they would have to do. Along with staying away from food, drink, intimacy, they would not speak at all. So that was their type of fasting. However, for us, it's slightly different. We stay away from food, we stay away from drinks, we stay away from intimacy, but fasting has been permitted. That's something Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has allowed. But despite that, when fasting is concerned, there's two types of fasting. There's a very basic level of fasting. There's the fasting that is related to our physical bodies, that we stay away from, you know, food and drink and intimacy. But then there's another level of fasting. And this fasting is more related to our spiritual aspect. In fact, a hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it mentions an incident of these two young women. They were brought to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they someone told Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam that, you know, these two young women, they're feeling sick. Something happened to them. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Go bring me a bowl. You know, I want them to vomit." And out of, you know, perplexity, these two women are saying, "But we were fasting. You know, what are we going to vomit out? We don't have anything in our stomachs." The Prophet then mentioned to them and everyone around them that these two young women engaged in what is called ghibah, backbiting, meaning speaking bad about other people behind their backs. And because of this, backbiting, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in the Quran, that a backbiting is like eating the flesh of your dead brother or dead sister, whatever it may be. So that was an actual miracle that took place during the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That although it was a figurative form of speech, it actually became something literal, where they ended up vomiting, you know, pieces of meat. But this was the spiritual elevated level of fasting, that along with abstaining from everything else, a person must be very aware, very cognizant of what they listen to, of what they see, what they say, how they behave. That's something we do all the time. That's something we're required to do all the time. We're always supposed to be aware of what we look at. We're always supposed to be aware of what we say. We're always supposed to be aware of what we hear, so on and so forth. But during that month of Ramadan, this importance has been increased. There should be an extra amount of vigilance. You know, just to give you an example, when you drive on the highway, or when you're driving in general, you're cautious, because especially when there's a lot of traffic, you know, you're cautious that you don't want to speed, you don't want to go above the speed limit, you don't want to drive recklessly, especially if you have, you know, children in your car. You're cautious in general, right? Nobody says that when I drive, if there's no one on the road, or if it's a good day, then I'll go 50, 60, 70 miles above the speed limit and I'll drive recklessly. You know, unless you're crazy, no one usually does that. Or if you're really young and you think you're really cool, right? And then you get your first speeding ticket and then you're like, you know, what do I do? But generally people don't do that. But when it rains, you know, so during, when you're driving in general, you're cautious. When it rains, you're cautious, but now you're even more cautious, because now you're concerned that, you know, there's extra hazards in the way. You know, the road is slippery. I have to be extra vigilant. Likewise, during the month of Ramadan, it's a month wherein we have to be extra vigilant, extra cautious of what we say, what we hear, what we do. Why? Because this is the month when we're giving up something which is halal. We're giving up food and we're giving up food, drinks, intimacy, things which are halal for us. We're giving away something which is halal for the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And by way of extension, it should mean that if we're willing to give up something halal for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, therefore we should be willing to give up something which is haram. Right? That's the concept, that's the understanding. And this is what fasting entails, that لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. That fasting, if you do so correctly, in the proper manner, in the ideal sense of fasting, then there is a good chance that you will become someone who is conscious of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You will be someone who protects yourself from the punishment and the wrath of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. However, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not mention that if people fast, then there's a guarantee that they will become righteous. Or if they fast, there's a guarantee that they will become God-fearing. Or there's a guarantee that they will become conscious of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in all given instances. That's not, and we see that as a reality. That so many, every year, you know, we're fasting. And how much of a change do we see in our own lives? Why? Because we are only fulfilling the basic requirement of fasting, which is simply abstaining from food and drink. But are we really fulfilling that spiritual aspect of fasting, the elevated level of fasting, whereby we are fully aware of how we behave, how we conduct ourselves, what we say, what we listen to, what we hear, what we see? You know, all these things have an effect on us. And this is very important to keep in mind, because the heart, because our eyes, our ears, these are all pathways to the heart. And the heart is the core of our essence, of our spirit. After we pass away from this world, it's our souls, our hearts that are going to be resurrected. And based on the condition of our heart, will dictate our final outcome. But if our heart is not taken care of, you know, the same way we nourish our body with healthy food, with nutritious food, likewise, we have to nourish our heart. And the pathways to the heart are our eyes, our ears. If we're constantly putting in junk, poison, toxic, through our ears, through our eyes, then that's what's going to be stored into the heart. And that's what will basically affect the heart. It will completely contaminate, destroy the heart. And that's the reality as we know it. You see, when people, when you first do something which is incorrect, you feel the sense of guilt. That's that natural, innate quality which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given to every single person. That generally, you know, a person is able to feel right from wrong. They have that ethical sense. But when a person continues to do something over and over again which is incorrect, then they become habituated. And then even the bad begins to look good to them. The bad begins to look attractive. The bad begins to look tempting. That's what happens. And that's because their hearts have been contaminated. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us from that. But nevertheless, over here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that fasting was something which had been given to all the previous nations. And fasting is the best, not the best, but one of the greatest ways of becoming someone who is conscious, becoming someone who is righteous. And if we take this opportunity, if we actually fast the way we're supposed to, then we will find the results. However, if we're fasting, if we're just doing the bare minimum and not really taking care of what we need to, or what we're supposed to, then fasting is not really gonna, you know, help us out or give us the desired results. But going back to the ayah where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about Ramadan, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, the month of Ramadan is the month when the Quran was revealed. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, before he was notified or informed by Jibreel alayhi salam that he was the prophet, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam would fast. He would, you know, stay. He would leave his family. He would go into the mountain, and he would meditate there. He would stay there. He would stay without food. He would stay without mixing with his family. You know, he had this sense of seclusion. And it was then when Jibreel alayhi salam came and informed Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam of his reality that you will soon become or you are the prophet. But what we understand from this is that if a person really wants to benefit from the Quran, if a person wants to become elevated, then there is a certain amount of seclusion, there is a certain amount of sacrifice a person has to give up physically. And this is what fasting entails. When a person is fasting, they're giving up their physical requirements, and in tandem along with that, when they are understanding the Quran, when they're reading the Quran, this will elevate and boost them spiritually. What we understand is if you want to benefit, if you want to elevate yourself spiritually, you have to give up aspects which are physical. And this has been recorded, mentioned over and over again in the hadith of Rasulullah ﷺ, in the ulama, the scholars of our past, the pious people of the past, they've all met. Fasting was a staple practice. It was something they would do all the time, because fasting elevates a person. Fasting really puts, really increases the spiritual level of a person. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that the month of Ramadan is the month when the Quran was revealed. And this is the first message that all of us should be understanding, that this is the month wherein we need to improve, rectify our relationship with the Quran. All of us sitting here, we are on different levels as far as our relationship with the Quran is concerned. For some of us, we have yet to learn how to read the Quran. For others, we have yet to finish our first round of the Quran. For others, it may be that we have to do a little brush up, a slight touch up on our tajweed. For others, it may be that what's the next surah I'm going to memorize. Whatever the case, no one is too far behind that they should lose hope. There's no such thing. In fact, the hadith of Rasulullah ﷺ, he makes it clear that the person who is able to recite the Quran correctly, the person who is able to recite the Quran with tajweed and in a beautiful manner, fluently, that person will be along, he will be in the ranks of the highest angels. That's his position, a very high, elevated, esteemed position. As for the person who has a difficult time reciting the Quran, for the person who stutters, isn't as fluent when he recites the Quran, even for that person, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has reserved two rewards. One reward for actually reciting the Quran, and another reward for going through that trouble of constantly being hassled while he is reading the Quran. Because when you're doing something that you're not fluent at, when you're doing something when you're not really good at, it's difficult. But if you continue to persevere, you'll succeed. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives that person two rewards, for actually reading the Quran and for persevering, for continuing to read even though it's difficult for that person. So there's no such thing. No one should tell themselves that, you know, I'm too far behind, I'm too old to learn how to read the Quran, or I'm too old to memorize the next surah, or I'm too young to do anything, whatever it may be. All of us have that opportunity, all of us have that capability to move forward. And this is the month to do so. This is the month of the Quran. So all of us have to really ask ourselves, what position, where am I as far as my relationship with the Quran is concerned? And then we have to move along accordingly. If, for example, someone says, my relationship with the Quran is that I have a few surahs memorized, I would like, then the next obvious question is, what do I want to do next? It's, I want to memorize a few more surahs, but along with that, I want to understand what I have memorized. I may know 5 or 6 surahs. Let me understand the meaning of these 5 or 6 surahs. And when you understand the meaning, then when you pray your salah, it'll be just so much more enjoyable. It won't be just you start your salah and you read or you recite things which you have no idea, you don't understand the meaning. It'll be a complete transformation. So make that intention right now. Make those goals, make those plans, that how am I going to improve my relationship with the Quran? Will it be I'll learn how to recite the Quran? Will it be I'll learn the meaning of the surahs that I've memorized? Will it be I'll memorize an additional surah? Whatever it may be, there's so many things to do. And we have not just one entire month. This is the month wherein we should put extra attention. extra focus on the Quran, but our studies as far as the Quran is concerned should be ongoing, should be till the day we pass away. And believe it or not, the Quran is not something you can ever exhaust. You can read the Quran once, twice, you can read it 1,000 times. You have not exhausted the knowledge, the benefit, the wisdom that the Quran contains. If you look at the books, the commentaries that the scholars have written on the Quran, you know, it's just amazing. You have commentaries of Quran that are 30 volumes, 40 volumes. You know, commentaries that speak about one single word over and just for pages on. Why? Because the Quran is full of wisdom. Understand that the Quran is not written by some human being. The Quran is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Al-Alim, Al-Hakim. He is all-knowing, He is all-wise. The Quran is full of wisdom. And if we're not going to tap into that wisdom, if we're not going to tap into that resource that's available right in front of us, then we're depriving ourselves. We really have no one to blame other than ourselves. Every single question that you can possibly have about life in this world is answered in the Quran. It's a guideline for us. It shows us right from wrong. And in this day and age where we are in deep need of that guidance, we're choosing to neglect the Quran. Why? Because, you know, we have some barriers. It may be that, you know, we don't understand the language. Well, that's a challenge. We have to understand the language of the Quran. You know, if you're not willing to work, you're not going to succeed. If a person simply says, I want to become, you know, an engineer, well, then the next thing you have to do is you have to enroll in a good university. You have to pay your fees. You have to, you know, come out with a $40 million, I don't know, loan, right? And that's your life. But you have to do something. Well, same thing with the Quran. If you're going to tell yourself, you know, it's in a different language, I don't understand it, well, that's your fault. You're really not going to benefit. As plain as it sounds bad, but that's the truth. If you want to become an engineer, you want to succeed, you want to become something useful, you have to work for it. No one's going to come and give you a diploma or a degree just because you sit at home and you know, do nothing. That's not how life works. That's not how life works, and that's not how the Quran works. That's not how anything in life works. If you want something, you have to work for it. And this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us in the Quran, that if you want to establish a relationship with the Quran, this is the month to optimize that relationship. This is the month wherein you really have to establish that deep connection with the Quran. And it doesn't happen overnight. It can happen over your entire lifespan. One of the beauties of that is the Quran was not revealed all at once. The Quran was not given to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam in one shot. The Quran was revealed to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam over a span of 23 years. Umar radiallahu anhu, he said it took him 12 years to memorize Surah Al-Baqarah. Right? 12 years to memorize Surah Al-Baqarah. Surah Al-Baqarah is about 2.5 juz. If a person really tries hard, they can memorize it in about a week or 2 weeks, depending on how good your memory is. For Umar radiallahu anhu, it took him 12 years. Why? Because every single ayah that he memorized, he made sure that he understood it and he implemented in his life. That's the sort of dedication they had. And because of that dedication, because of that commitment, they became one of the greatest people, one of the greatest Muslims to have ever lived. So if our goal in life is to become someone who is devoted to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if our goal in life is to become a devout Muslim, then this is the first step we need to take. We need to establish a relationship with the Quran. We have to become dedicated. We have to become committed. We have to put in work every single day. And again, you move slowly. No one's saying that by tomorrow you have to memorize the entire Quran, you have to understand every single word in the Quran. That's not possible. It can take you 10 years. It can take you 12 years. It can take you for your entire life. The point is, as long as you're moving forward, as long as you're understanding something new, as long as you're developing yourself and establishing that relationship inch by inch, every single day, you are succeeding. You are accomplishing your goal. And that's what has to be kept in mind. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, out of His sheer mercy, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala looks at your intention. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not look at the results. If your intention, if your commitment to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is that you will try your best to understand everything in the Quran and practice it. And even if it doesn't happen, but that's your intention. On the Day of Judgment, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will reward you accordingly. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will reward you according to your intention, not on the results you have produced. And that's the beauty, that's the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says the Quran was revealed during the month of Ramadan. The Quran is a guide, hudan linnas. It is a guide which guides mankind. Bayinat min al-huda wal furqan. That there are signs of guidance in the Quran, and it is something of furqan. It tells us right from wrong. In this day and age, where you know we're constantly fighting over whether this sort of behavior is right or if this act is incorrect, here's the Quran gives us all those answers. That is this really the lifestyle for me? Is this the correct lifestyle for us? So on and so forth. After mentioning all that, after introducing the month of Ramadan being the month of the Quran, then second, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَمَنْ شَهِدَ مِنْكُمُ الشَّهْرَ فَلْيَسُمْ. That if you are present during this month, meaning if you're alive during the month of Ramadan, then you need to fast. So what's the first thing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned about the month of Ramadan? It's the month of the Quran. The second is that it's the month of fasting. So you have to understand that fasting is definitely important. It's something all of us have to do. But we also have to make sure that we are establishing, we are creating, and we are developing our relationship with the Quran. Because that's how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala introduced the month of Ramadan. You know, don't misunderstand this. Don't think as long, you know, unfortunately, many people believe as long as you're fasting, then you know, you've somehow fulfilled your obligation during the month of Ramadan. You're fasting, but you never pray. You're fasting, but you're not coming to the masjid. You're fasting, but you're not reading the Quran. Your entire life has not changed one bit, aside from the fact that you wake up and you don't eat. You eat about, you know, 6-7 hours later, or whatever it may be. If that's the only difference in your life, then, you know, I'm sorry to say this, but Ramadan really hasn't changed you or anything. We've misunderstood the point of Ramadan. If that's the only difference that we have in mind, that tomorrow I'll wake up early, have my breakfast, and then you know 16 hours later I'll break my fast. If that's the only difference, then we've misunderstood the month of Ramadan, the purpose of Ramadan. On the other hand, if we tell ourselves that along with fasting, this month, I'll be extra cautious, extra wary of my behavior, of my conduct, of my speech, and I'll try my best to establish a relationship with the Quran, then alhamdulillah, we've understood the message, the purpose of the month of Ramadan. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to acquire maximum benefit from the month of Ramadan. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to take full opportunity and full reward of the month of Ramadan. You know, just to share one hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam during the month of Ramadan, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "Man sama Ramadana imanan wa ihtisaban ghufira lahu ma taqaddama min dhanbi." That the person who fasts during the month of Ramadan, imanan, as a Muslim, wa ihtisaban, and with the hope of receiving reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when we fast, there's two things that all of us need to be Muslim. So that's the easy part. All of us, alhamdulillah, are Muslim. The second thing is that when we fast, our intention should only be for the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We're fasting only for Allah. We're fasting only for the reward that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving. Then the reward for that is غُفِرَ اللَّهُ مَا تَقَدَّمَ مِنْ ذَنْبِ. Then the sins of that person, all the sins that the person had previously committed, will be forgiven. Another hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he says, "Man qama Ramadana imanan wa ihtisaban ghufira lahu ma taqaddama min dhanbi." That the person who stands up to pray during the month of Ramadan, and in specific the Salat al-Tarawih, the person who prays that, then again, as a Muslim and as a person hoping for the mercy and the reward of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then his past sins will be forgiven. So there's two great things. You know, the month of Ramadan is the month of the Quran. It's also the month of mercy. It's the month of forgiveness. It's the month wherein Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala releases and frees many people from the fire of Jahannam. So this is the month where we really have to understand and take full benefit, take full advantage of this. And inshallah, throughout the month of Ramadan, we'll be discussing more and more about the virtues of Ramadan. So till the last day, we can truly benefit from the month of Ramadan. And as all of us are fully aware, that during the month of Ramadan is Laylatul Qadr, the night of power, the night of decree. And this is the month. This is the night wherein the reward of it is, it's better than 80 months, you know, subhanAllah. So these are things that we should keep be aware of and look out for and plan ahead so that we can take full benefit of these things. Ameen. بارك الله لنا ولكم في القرآن المجيد ونفعنا وإياكم بالآيات وذكر الحكيم أستغفر الله لي ولكم ولسائر المسلمين فاستغفروا إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. الحمد لله الذي أرسل رسوله بالهدى ودين الحق ليظهره على الدين كله وكفى بالله شهيدا ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. Dear brothers and sisters, before we finish off, there's a few announcements that I'd like to make. First of all, as you see, our expansion project has begun. Alhamdulillah. This is phase one of our expansion project. And the details of it, inshallah, Brother Bilal will explain to us after the salah. But my point over here is that you see, you know, the fruits of your sacrifices. You know, this masjid, what we're aiming for, it cannot be possible without your contribution, without the sacrifice from our community. This is a masjid that belongs to all of us. All of us are equal owners in this masjid. This is a facility that is open to every single one of us, to us and to our future generations. And all of us are very aware, we're very familiar of how important it is to have a masjid, to have a facility where our children, where we can come and just designate ourselves for the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is not possible unless we are willing to contribute. It's not possible unless we are willing to make that sacrifice. You know, no one's gonna say, you know, here's $1 million, I'm not from the community, just take it and build it. It's us that we have to make the sacrifices, we have to make sure that we have something for ourselves and our future children. So with that, you know, I encourage everyone that during the month of Ramadan, when our rewards are doubled, tripled, multiplied by the tens and thousands, you know, please take this opportunity to donate generously as much as you can. And we're not asking that, you know, you empty out your entire bank account. We're saying give what is feasible for you. If a dollar is feasible for you, then so be it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will again reward you according to your intention, right? But the point is, it's that intention that matters. If you can afford to give more, then please do so. You know, this is good, going for a good cause. This money is not coming to any one of us associated or affiliated with the masjid. It's being used to build the masjid so that we can have proper facilities for our future generations, inshallah. Along with that, tonight, inshallah, we'll be having our family night. We spoke a little bit about Ramadan today, but tonight we'll speak more about fasting tonight, and it's at 7:30, so please be here with your family. Everyone is welcome and invited. Tomorrow we have another youth program concerning Ramadan, which starts at 4 o'clock. So all the youth, all parents, please send your youth over here. All the children are invited. We'll also be starting Ramadan programs and activities like last year. We'll give out information, we'll mail out the information, we'll email the information, inshallah. And once Ramadan starts, our Salat times will be a little different. Salatul Fajr will be 4:30 throughout the month of Ramadan, and Salatul Isha will be 10:15 throughout the month of Ramadan. After Salatul Isha, we will be giving 2 or 3 minutes to pray the Sunnah, and then immediately after that, we will begin our Salatul Taraweeh. Salatul Taraweeh will be 8 rakahs. After the first 4, we will be taking a small break wherein we deliver a small word of advice, and then we'll be continuing on. And inshallah, that will be the schedule for the month of Ramadan. Inshallah, jazakallah khair. إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون فاذكروا الله يذكركم واشكروه ولا تكفرون. أقيموا الصلاة.